very good morning to you all. Dear dignitaries, our guests at the VIP area, all international guests who are still trying to cope up with their bio clocks and time zones, and every important stakeholder of the industry who's here in this hall, a warm welcome to you to Nutrify Today, C-Suite Summit, and the mission $100 billion. Thank you. $100 billion by 2030. A journey that has already started, and this is not a Nutrify Today mission. It's a mission that has been adopted by Nutraceutical Task Force of India, which is working very closely with Government of India, which is shaping the policies and setting up opportunities within India and outside of India to create a large momentum growth. Because if this happens, India would be the second largest nutraceutical industry in the world, and a great opportunity for all of you. Today on 17th of June this year, we're launching world's first nutraceutical industry networking and business platform that would work with the industry in transforming it into a inter-country, inter-markets, democratized market access. This will help startups in India and outside the world be able to access the markets with ease and help evolve responsible nutraceutical business in India and in other countries. The platform is having 18,000 industry members who are onto it, and it is fast expanding, and we look forward to having 100,000 industry members by same time next year. And what is more important is this platform, as I said, is enabling business in the field of nutraceuticals. It is very much aligned to the national agenda, which is set up by National Task Force for Nutraceuticals in India, of achieving $100 billion nutraceutical industry by 2030. The platform is enabling business and transaction. Today we have with us some of the global industry leaders here, right from Rakshit Mehta from Switzerland. We have Mr. Sanjay Mariwala, the chairperson of OmniActive, Mr. Eric Kasten, who's the CEO for Fuji Chemicals Japan, Dr. Anand Swarup, the president for CFIM Incorporated USA, Carl Gibson, CEO for Complementary Medicine Australia. We have Mr. John Shin from South Korea, a leading business giant in South Korea, and a law firm, Mr. Irwin. Happy to share that this platform has enabled, between morning 9 a.m. to now, about 22 or 25 MOUs that have been signed, and the total investment value that has come into India during 9 a.m. to now is $30 million, split between the South Korean company, the Swiss company, and an American company. I would take this opportunity to have leaders talk about this platform launch today and their commitment to Indian market as India marches ahead to be a $100 billion nutraceutical industry.
And as you know, Ayurveda has a lot of potential in providing the good market and in providing the good health to the community all over the world, and not only in India. And in that also, the main three pillars of health, they are the diet, sleep, and the activities. And the main focus of Ayurveda is on the promotion of health. And when we say in the promotion of health, it is the diet which is the most important thing. And when we say diet, this diet is applicable not only for the overall general being, but actually it has the specialties like the internal medicine for the pediatric problem, for the gynec problem, for the geriatric problem, and so on. So the diet has linkages with all the various sectors. And moreover, it is also constitution based, like the Vata, Pitta and Kapha. You know, these are the basic body constitutions, and the diet has a lot of role in the body constitution as well. And this diet actually works as per the body constitution. So when we develop the nutraceutical, these things actually we have to keep in mind.
So good morning, everyone. I'm delighted to be a part of Nutrify today, Institute Summit. And I'm so happy to see global participation in this summit. As we all know, that nutraceutical is a fusion of food tech, pharmaceutical, biotech, as well as Ayurveda. And India has all the necessary expertise and resources to lead in this domain. So Ayurvedic and traditional knowledge play a critical role in this sector. Indeed, almost 2000 years ago, Hippocrates correctly emphasized that let food be your medicine and medicine be your food.
Good morning to you all, distinguished dignitaries and participants of this meeting. I would like to thank at the very outset Nutrify today, Amit and Sarah, thank you very much for inviting me. And all the speakers who have just spoken before me, Professor Sood, Dr. Manoj Nasari and Gibson, it has been a pleasure to hear all of you. So I represent Indian Pharmaceutical Alliance, and as all of you know that pharmaceuticals, account India is known as pharmacy of the world. We sell every third tablet in US is sold from India, every fourth tablet in Europe is sold from India, and India is the powerhouse of pharmaceuticals. All of us can be proud of the fact here sitting today, we are associated with healthcare, and we have played a very important role throughout the world by consistently supplying the medicines.
My name is Anand Swaroop. I am a founder and a president of a company called Cepham Inc. We are based in Somerset, New Jersey, serving mainly markets in USA. Amit asked me to share my thoughts with rest of you what we think about traditional medicine. And traditional medicine is something which is very close to my heart. Growing up, my family was very much dependent on traditional medicine. We came from a village, and the only access we had to any kind of preventive medicine was traditional medicine. But then what we know as a traditional medicine over the years, there's a need to change, there have to be a paradigm shift on traditional medicine. As we know, traditional medicine is around for thousands of years in our country and different civilizations around the world. You know, you look at China, they have TCM, they have Ayurveda, you have a part of Greek medicine, you have parts of Eastern Europe, they also have their own medicine system, not that old, but everybody have got traditional medicine because the modern medicine is just a few, maybe not even 100 years old.
We're going to do supply chain. We'll talk about supply chain trends, innovation. And you know, speaking of innovation, we've got some innovation, a innovation award, one innovation award we're going to be giving away later today. It's in here, and we'll find out who the winner is. Even I don't know. It was sealed by somebody.
Good afternoon to you all. Hope no one is sleeping. If anyone feels sleepy, that means you are already on the pathway to getting diabetes. You have insulin resistance, so I'll wake you up. And also it tells you that maybe you have eaten so much of rice, because you know, I was also tempted to eat rice. I love rice, by the way, but since my speech is the first, I thought I should not fall asleep standing on the stage. Okay, when this topic was given to me by Amit asked me to choose a topic. And I chose this because this is what I do every day. I meet so many companies and everyone comes to me and says, can you do a miracle product which helps to cure diabetes?
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Dhaval Katkar. That's a topic for me to talk about with you today for the next 20 minutes. What I thought is that, you know, when Amit told me about talking about Da Vinci Code, I thought, let me just take a step back and understand the 5W1H framework so that I'll try and put things into that perspective for the audience. So hopefully you'll see some complexities about building businesses in India. That's my intention today. I'm a big fan of reading nonfiction. One of the things, I had a good fortune of meeting Mr. Goldratt, and he made one comment in one of the meetings that nobody has bought till the consumers have bought. Everything else is pipeline filling. And it just, from that day, stuck with me. I thought it's a very important thing as you guys are discussing the entire supply chain side.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'd like to start off by thanking Amit very much for the invitation to speak here. I guess that Amit and I talked a few years ago when he was just thinking about this idea of Nutrify today, and a wonderful vision. And it's not only about the vision, it's about the execution, right? Lots of people have vision, but I think Amit also had the execution. So wonderful to see this event, and congratulations to Amit and the team and everybody who arrived today. And the second thing is, it's fantastic to be back here in India after 3 years, lockdown, COVID, previous life, and to see so many friends, colleagues, etc. from the industry at this occasion. And with that, we'll move on. What I'd like to talk a little bit about here is, I think, a little bit about the elephant in the room. And the elephant in the room for me, and thank you, Anand, it was a great segue to some of the things that I'm going to say also, is about R&D and innovation in our industry.
So friends, how this goes, as you've heard a lot of August speakers today, they've talked about the huge opportunity what India offers in terms of nutraceuticals, right? And now, you know, how does the markets, the categories which are there, the case studies which have been built, the challenges which are there. Now here what we have is a panel of 5 members who will talk about what happens now when you get the product. How do you make it a success in India? What are the different types of GTM models which you can go through? How do you crack the code of switching from RX to OTC? What are the some of the regulatory FSSAI regulatory barriers which a nutraceutical should not cross, and definitely what are some of the quality assurance things. So now we're getting into more of downstream, what happens when you have a product.
Thank you, Mr. Baker, for the introduction. Thank you to Nutrify for hosting this wonderful event, bringing like-minded people under one roof. So how's the energy in the room? Not so much. Next time I'll be sure to bring one of our products. It's a caffeine melting mouth. Do reach out to me if you want to try some. So today I'll be discussing harnessing the power of innovation, but not specifically focusing on technological or product innovation, but looking at innovation across the value chain. But just before that, quick introduction about Biogen Extracts. We are a B2B ingredient manufacturer, but we've always been consumer focused. So,
my background and my target is somewhat different than other speakers in this conference, because I'm a molecular biologist, and I was trained in genomics and the medical genetics from City of Hope Medical Center and the Harvard Medical Schools. So I'm more focusing on my passion and what I have done in the genomics research. And I've been working a lot in the more of the pharmaceutical and the clinical diagnostic applications. But as my company EDGC and Diagnomics has been involved a lot of consumer applications, and I had an opportunity to working with the nutrigenomics and other consumer area as well.
Distinguished guests and delegates, a good afternoon for all our Australian colleagues here today. I think we're mid-afternoon. I for some reason I have a comfortable seat at the very front, so if I start nodding off, please do give me a nudge. Firstly, a little about me. I'm the Chief Executive of Complementary Medicines Australia, which is the peak industry body of complementary medicines in Australia. We look after the whole supply chain. My background is politics. I was a special advisor to Margaret Thatcher, if you remember Margaret when she was Prime Minister in the UK. I moved to venture capital and launched eScripts, which is electronic health records in America for all scriptomyces, before moving over to Australia where I was at Blackmores and now head of Complementary Medicines Australia. And barring any mishaps, I should be elected as Vice President of the World Trade Association next week, fingers crossed.
There's always a pre-COVID and a post-COVID world, and nowhere is it as relevant as this whole immuno-building thing that we've seen in the last, say, 3 years. Now, we've done an interesting comparison here. The gentleman from Australia some time back mentioned that Australia is a very developed market in that sense. You know, there's a speed and there's an acceleration. I think what we Indians need to be very proud of, we may not have had the speed, but we definitely have the acceleration. So if you see, on some parameters, we've actually been a bit more forward-thinking than a lot of the world. Family health, more importantly, the buying behavior that has changed a lot.
I'm honored and humbled to be here to speak with Dr. Rajiv today. Dr. Rajiv and I became very close dear friends yesterday.
That's right.
And it's the background that you have and what you've done for the community, for the health and awareness of India and around the world is truly impressive. And I thought maybe we could start by, if you can share a little bit about how you moved from becoming a pediatrician originally into the health and wellness space. I thought it was fascinating, the timing and your transition into the space.
Thank you, Linda. So first of all, as Linda mentioned, we virtually met yesterday for 10 minutes and then we met today in person in this iconic Crystal Hall, thanks to Amit. I mean, I do want to put on record a sincere appreciation to Amit, who's brought me into this fantastic group of entrepreneurs, academic leaders, government professionals, policy makers, and so on and so forth. Trying to answer what Linda has asked me, so I started as becoming a pediatrician and a neonatologist, and I'm one of those who was educated in the only rural medical college in India, called Mahatma Gandhi Institute of Medical Sciences, in the place where Gandhiji actually lived for many, many years, called Sevagram.
Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you so much for the conference organizers, particularly Amit and Vishnu, for having invited me today. I want to talk to you about the potential of Malaysia being the gateway to ASEAN. I mean, ASEAN is becoming an increasingly powerful grouping of nations that are growing rapidly, that have in them the population of slightly half of what India is and two times what the United States is, growing in some cases double digits. Population of roughly 32 million people. As you can see, it's a growing population. The numbers are growing, and therefore Malaysia represents a good consumption base while being the gateway to ASEAN. It's a growth market. We are all the markets growing. Every single country in ASEAN grows and has bounced back relatively well post-COVID.
Thank you very much, and also thanks for the organizing committee to have me on stage today. I would like you in the coming 20 minutes take you through the world of medical food, and I think in India indeed, where I learned to know the market, it's in every country actually, it has its own kind of specificities. And in India, what I really like is that the nutraceutical market is already quite medicalized. However, the medical food market as such is still quite immature, and I think there's a lot of opportunities to work on. I will give a scope on the global market, but also a little bit my own kind of reflection on the Indian market, which might not be accurate because, as you can see, I'm not from India. I'm from the Netherlands. So, first, quickly about myself. I have indeed a PhD on medical sciences with a focus on cholecystokinin receptors, which is important for the regulation of hunger and satiety. And that was actually my link to the specialized nutrition market. 25 years ago, I joined Nutritia, which is now owned by Danone. So sometimes I say Nutritia, sometimes Danone, but I'm Dutch. Nutritia was Dutch, Danone is French. And so there's a bit of a kind of a feeling there. Nevertheless, I enjoyed working there till 2 years ago.
So today, the title of my talk is the role of Indian CDMO in delivering the high quality nutraceuticals for the global market. So this term nutraceutical was actually coined in 1989 by Stephen, and it comprises of two words, the nutrition and pharmaceuticals. So primarily, I mean, those food components which can give you some purposes, some additional value beyond their inherent nutritionals. So actually, we all knew, and in fact, part of this, I think we also covered in my the previous presenter, that the malnutrition will kill us. And we also knew that the obesity will also kill. So end of the day, what was more important was the right kind of a food, the right kind of a nutrition at the right kind of a dose was something which is very, very important and very, very critical for a healthy lifestyle.
Hello everyone, my name is Kenny. I'm from Johannesburg, South Africa, and I'm here representing FlavorWiki today. FlavorWiki is a digital insights company that is focused on the food and ingredient industry. As you'll see in this presentation, we offer a variety of services, but we are mostly focused on helping food and beverage companies understand their customer better and make better products for them to succeed in business. At the end of the day, we are all trying to sell more. When you look at food and beverages or anything with an aroma, it is very difficult for people to understand how to describe these and understand how to quantify these. That's why FlavorWiki was started, to better understand individual consumers from the perspective of what they taste, what they experience, and then to use that information to better understand what drives their purchase decisions.
I'm really honored to be here and to present the project we did last 4 to 5 years. And especially, I'm very happy that we could manage to introduce something, a total new concept for a new novel concept for an existing and a well-spread disease. So when I come to the presentation, so what we see is that we are Belgian. Everybody knows Belgium, and we are very proud about it. And our innovative concept that we have is that we are really looking for new solutions for unmet needs. So it's important to have these unmet needs. And the microbiome is something really, really interesting. Everybody knows probiotics. I believe worldwide antibiotic-associated diarrhea is treated everywhere by probiotics. Lots of markets coming up. Our colleague of William Reed was talking about the gut-brain axis. A lot of new research about immunity, about the gut-vagina axis. But we focus on a new domain, and that's what I want to present today.
Thank you very much, Sheldon, for introducing Triphase and me. Amit sir, it's absolute pleasure and honor to be here on this stage discussing about the work that we have been engaged in for last 13 years. And I'm hoping that even though I am the last person to speak on this stage, I'll keep you entertained enough with this research that I have that you will not feel a pinch of staying back so long. So thank you very much. If anything COVID did good to all of us, except that bringing the whole world to its knees was that we all suddenly got worried about our health. We suddenly got worried about our immunity. And the buzzword which was there all over the world was how to increase this immunity so that we would not be affected with the COVID.
Nutraceuticals Task Force, Sanjay, that's been set up, and it starts with propelling India in terms of research, manufacture and market access, and position the country in terms of a trajectory of a $100 billion market. But I want to understand what's kept this market on hold till now.
I would say, as anything new, you know, you need to learn and discover new things in an industry, and you need to adapt to those. And I think that's what we are trying to do, is adapt to some of the changes that are taking place. And the government needs to learn what needs to be done by them, and the industry needs to learn what needs to be done by them. So if you look at maybe three or four elements, you know, we don't have an industry status within this country. We are diffused industry, you know, spread over between spices and herbals and Ayush and many other sectors. So you really don't have a consolidated industry base. We think that one of the areas which qualifies very nicely for this industry is the PLI scheme, which the government of India has nicely come up with. I think a good PLI scheme designed for the industry can aid it grow much quicker and faster. For instance, we don't have HSN codes for this industry. Okay, so we really cannot track and monitor our progress. Where are we making progress? The government doesn't know where we are making progress, so we don't have a common language to speak with the government. Okay. Lack of incubation hubs, perhaps whatever effort takes place in an industry which is new is in entrepreneurial spirit that brings it out, and companies like us that make new things happen. But the government has to also facilitate certain roles for the incubation to take place. And one key issue is the contradictions sometimes that we come up with within a democracy like ours, which is a challenging biodiversity act, which affects the availability of raw materials, for instance, in a case like ours. Mm. These are a few of the big factors that actually are coming in the way today, if you look at why we are slow at this moment.
But as you said, where the market appears diffuse, as it comes together and there is more collaboration, then India can actually...
I think this is where we can start looking at if the players understand the needs of the market, spend a little more time investing in research and study and understanding the markets, and look at what needs to be done to iron out some of these creases. And I think that's when things will start flowing in a far better...
All right. From taking a step back, let's understand what's the situation on the ground currently. Dr. Swarup, what are the opportunities for investment in nutraceuticals in India? I believe we are one of the top suppliers for medicinal plants and herbs in the world, but there's still a lot of ground to cover. So in terms of investment opportunities, where do things stand here?
Just tremendous opportunity which I see to invest in Indian market as well as Asian Pacific market along with India, because the things are very much common. If you look at India, the average age is under 30 years, a young nation. And any young nation to path of being prosperous and successful, you have to keep them healthy, mentally as well as physically. That actually presents you with a tremendous opportunity. You have to find a definition of nutrition for this population. You have to make sure that their needs are met by homegrown nutrition, which is basically tradition-based. People are accepting them, and it's going to appeal to masses. And that's where I see a tremendous opportunity for companies from outside of India to invest in this market and actually learn from this market to take the innovation back home and actually enrich their own population from the self-care revolution.
So India could actually become a sort of a test bed for all the global nutraceuticals industry to actually learn and apply those lessons and grow across the world.
I would not say it's a test bed. I mean, it's more like this is a tremendous population. Mm. You are looking at the size which is bigger than any other country on the face of Earth. And if you take this population, if you take this number of people and meet their nutrition needs, that's a huge learning. Mm. Which you can take it back home and then apply them.